My presentation is about how students use basic software. I'm using the word basic here to mean ideally the gadgets and facilities that we have already in place. So we are not going to yearn for what is far, what is out of our reach, but with what we have at hand, with the facilities that we have in our different departments, how are we going to try and get students on board to use of the ICT tools? That's what we are going to be looking at. Now, the basic ones we are having, I could just name, we have the computers, we are lucky we have the internet back and full. Now, with the computers, we have the internet facilities, maybe the students' phones. We are all just going to brainstorm and think about just what we have in place. So my interest will be emphasizing more on how the students, because while we are enriching ourselves, we are letting the students lag behind. So the framework on which we are supposed to be orienting ourselves on, that framework of ICT is a guide to how we can all come on board to have basic skills in ICT use, both in teaching and learning. It's not just one-sided. The basic, can they do typing? Majority of them are coming in, and when you're saying go and type an assignment, they are going to just pay someone. Can they try to type? Can they use simple things like emails to send a message? So that's what our focus is on today. So the basic ones we are looking at are the common software, including using Microsoft Word, Excel, PowerPoint, those fall under the word processor. Then social networking, when we are talking about WhatsApp, Facebook, can we tap what the youth are really interested in to be used in a classroom situation? Can we use also web-based resources now that we have the internet? Apart from getting the notes out of it, what else can we try to explore about the internet? And then the other one is to encourage participants to select tools, learning aids, and equipment within their subject areas. So the things that we have, I'm looking at Microsoft Word, the PowerPoints. For us, we are able to type our notes, most of us. We'll try to do some typing. All of us may have the emails, but what about our students? How are we going to be? It's going to take a creative teacher to come up with a well-designed task that is going to bring these students on board. And I say, now we are discussing about this. I want everyone's views. And it's very interesting that wherever they are seeing who is commenting, who is discussing. You can go to a Google Drive. Maybe you open up your email account. When you click on Drive. There's what you find something like new. You can create folders for where you can upload. You see something like Google Docs. Mm-hmm. Are we together?
Yes.
Google Docs. You can see Google Sheets, Google Slides. Now, the Google Docs are like the ordinary Microsoft Word document. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to just request one of you to write, to be like your position. You are the lecturer and the rest are students. Mm-hmm. Then you feel... You just try to experience what it means to collaborate. Go to new, so you can open the Google Doc. So what comes up is something untitled document.
Yeah.
Yes. So that untitled document is where I usually put like assignments, maybe what you want, maybe task one. I'm going to use Doctor
the task.
Then she will share with you as students. Eh? Mm. So let's suppose it is assignment one or coursework one, here, where there is untitled document, but all of you can still create your tasks and share them. Go ahead and put your coursework, task, or describe what you want. On the right, share. On the upper right, after you have set the task, write your question in the main document. So yes, when you share, so now here, there is a box that drops up. Eh? Here, you enter the email addresses of your students. That means you'll have that list. Eh?
Sorry, let me enter those of people.
Yes.
Can I enter for here?
Yes, you enter there.
No, God, give me your email address.
It says you can allow them edit. Sometimes you are sharing just notes where you want them to just receive and see, but add nothing to it.
Yes.
You can allow them to edit. Sometimes you just want them to comment, and sometimes you want them to just see. So we allow them to edit. Then if it's already ticked, then you can go and send.
So try to answer the question that you have received. So wherever you are, you're seeing the people online. They are discussing, and you can even comment somewhere on the left, on the right up their comments. So try to answer some, put some responses. And when you give a task in the beginning, you'll be online as well, because when you're telling them work in the Google document, some people will be sending you emails. So you keep redirecting them. So be there knowing they are also trying to learn. So don't give it and leave it up to them. From here I can see Elizabeth is answering. I don't know, Elizabeth should be able to see John, I mean Mr. Court as well, as giving responses. So that is what will be the beauty. And then the role of the teacher, wherever, even if it's a collaboration activity, give comments to encourage. Don't put it as a task and spend 1 month. Let there be a time limit. They are sharing and you're giving feedback. Encourage them, give comments to direct them. You don't have to do that task, but give them hints. Maybe someone, is this really correct? What do you think about this? So you'll find pages. So you can set, in the beginning, they will not easily accept it. But as time goes on, they will learn and it becomes exciting.
Highlight
and give a comment. If you have a problem with that, highlight and give. But the way we give the comments should be to encourage, not to discourage, because they are also learning. They are struggling with typing, using the new tool. So when you discourage, they quickly give up, or pointing at where you want. So that the person knows where the problem is. It's for them to learn the skill of collaboration. So I may not in the end actually attach a mark to it. Or as long as anybody took part, I'll give a general mark. So I don't really attach so much. And then the only way I put, I emphasize to them that I encourage them to take it serious, is either I'll bring a kind of a question related to it in a test or an exam, so they will know that it was actually meant for business. So just go back to your email. Somewhere up there is M. So you go to new. It's already there. New in your drive. This time we are going to Google Sheets. He's already there. To the drive, you always just go to this. When you click there, you see Gmail. This point allows you to go back to your mail. This is Google Drive. Google Plus is like a social network, YouTube, that all that.
So we are much.
So you click and go to the drive.
Is Excel now, or what is it?
It is, this works like Excel. Google Sheet works like Excel. Google Document works like Word. Google Slides are like PowerPoint.
Do you have Google Sheets?
Okay, so the same thing. You can say coursework one, task one, and then we start. I can show you how to merge. I'm going to do it, then you'll do it. Just select, I'm pressing down. You know how to select, So I'm selecting this. Oh dear. Okay. I'm selecting just this line. Maybe up to where I want. That is just selecting. Just creating a flat space.
So there is what we call Kahoot. Someone was asking me what is Kahoot. Now Kahoot is a quiz that we can use with our students. There is another one called Hot Potato. I've not ventured into it, but seems to be another interesting one.
That question.
Kahoot. Yes. So Kahoot can be used at the beginning to introduce something. It's almost like game-based. It just tries to vary the methods, the tradition of learning, to a game-based way of learning. So they don't really feel the pressure like they are doing a test. But the results will show that Joanne has scored this, so and so. They are ideally being assessed. Maybe you want, it's a pre-assessment, or it's an end of your course task. Eh? Mm. So that is what Kahoot is like. So I created the Kahoot, and later maybe we'll go through the process of how we can create one. So I begin by just sharing one that I made. So it is a free, you create your own account, like how you create for maybe an email address. So I created one on fractions, but they are simple fractions. So I'm supposing you are my students, and I created one. So when I come to class, when I have used the Kahoot in class, because my students at the college are usually beginners, so I'll have one evening to try and make them familiar about logging into. Because when I say now, log into Kahoot, they don't know what logging. So I take time, so they know that when I say we are logging into Kahoot, I'm saving time for the lesson. So maybe in the evening I'll have to task some, and I'm hard on them to make sure when I say it's time for Kahoot, everyone sits and they know what to do. So Kahoot, when we are logging into Kahoot, so type www.kahoot.it. It will ask you for a game pin. Try to go to a new window, move away from the Google slide. I prepared my quiz ahead of time. When I'm in class, I've already prepared it and saved it into my account. So it asks you for a game pin. So the game pin will show. So to do the Kahoot, you need a projector or a screen, that because the students can only see the questions here. You'll either need, we are now using a projector, or you can directly use the smart screen there. That is, where are they asking for a game pin? You enter that number.
I enter.
Yes, then it will ask you for a nickname. You can use your own name or you nickname yourself. And when you give yourself a name and you have entered, you'll see your name there. So I, for now, I have zero players. So we already have one player, Prof. Then we have Biggs. We have Ali. You see, I have Steven. Can we have more people logging in? About you getting the correct answer only. Even if we all get the correct answer, the first person to get it tops, takes the first position. So you have to be attentive. The question and options to tick, you'll see them here, but tick on your computer. You have to read the question, and then you see symbols for which you which have the correct answer, and you have to tick there on yours. And it is timed, so you have only 20 seconds to answer every question. It is about speed and accuracy. You read the question there, and the options are only projected here. Your computer, you're only clicking the correct option. The questions are going to display only here, and the options are here. So when you pick your correct option, you tick it, you click on it quickly from your computer. So it's about fractions, 10 questions. That's question one. Question one. It's counting down. Click the correct answer there. Which is of those is correct, and click there on your computer.
I have clicked and said, "Q-genius."
Only two people have clicked the time up.
Yes, I am one of them.